Big Blue Files of the Internet, today I'm here to recommend some books based on my favorite shows of 2022. Besides reading books, I love consuming visual media. Again, books aside, I would say it's my favorite way of consuming stories, because at the end of the day, whether it's a reality show, a drama series, a competition, an adaptation, a movie, it's all stories. There are two little footnotes for this. First, I only included series I thought I could match with books, so this is not a definitive favorite TV show list by any means. And also, I only counted series that I started and finished in 2022, because for me, in order to declare something as a favorite, I have to finish it first. So there's no partially watched or incomplete series that can't stand on their own as it is, which sadly means that there's no anime on this list, and I do watch a fuck ton of anime, so that is unfortunate. But again, for the purposes of this video, I am still excited to talk about all of these. This first series is coming in clutch, it's top of mind, I just marathoned through it a few weeks ago within days of its release, and that is 1899. Now I am going to give synopses for these shows because I know not everyone has equal access to the same kinds of media. So 1899 was a very pleasant surprise, it's a twisty, dark, fascinating mindfuck of a show that scratches so many parts of my brain in the best possible way. It starts off as a pretty straightforward historical piece set in, you guessed it, 1899, and there is a young English woman named Moira who's one of many people embarking on a voyage from Southampton to the US. She's sort of uniquely positioned because her father owns the fleet that their ship belongs to, and she's on this voyage because she received a strange letter from her brother who famously went missing along with thousands of other people on a different ship called the Prometheus. So she doesn't know how she got this letter, and she's convinced her father has something to do with the Prometheus's and her brother's disappearance. Then everything changes when the captain announces that they've received a distress signal from the Prometheus. It is buck fucking wild, to say the absolute least. It's also this incredibly ambitious, multilingual show with an all-star cast of characters who are so distinctive and so compelling. The story itself is original, exciting, unexpected, and it does such a great job of blending together so many different genres. It's got elements of mystery, thriller, historical drama, maybe even some speculative stuff. I'm not trying to say too much, but it just made my brain very, very happy. So with that in mind, the book I would pair with the series is The Sea of Tranquility by Emily St. John Mandel. This is another story with an incredibly ambitious scope. It follows multiple characters across time who all experience a unique phenomenon that they can't quite explain. Basically, there's a tree in the Canadian wilderness, and when people go there, they hear this strange blending of sounds that don't quite go together or make any kind of sense. And this phenomenon has only been witnessed by a handful of people between the 1900s and the 2200s. So we're following a time-traveling investigator who's interviewing everyone affected by this experience and basically trying to piece together what this phenomenon is, how it connects these people, and whether or not it's dangerous. I think this book and this series pair perfectly together because what drew me into both of them was that incredibly strong element of mystery, these very strange, inexplicable phenomena that don't seem to make any sort of logical sense. I think the joy of experiencing both of these stories comes from trying to piece together whether these wildly different characters are connected, whether there's an explicit pattern between them, or if it's just coincidence and they just happen to have an overlap in their circumstances. Both of these series are really interrogating how you make sense of the impossible when sense itself is completely taken out of the equation, and how we define what is real for ourselves when the parameters of what we understand as real are changing on a minute-by-minute basis. I do have an honorable mention for this that I have not read myself yet, but I hope to read very soon, and that is Dead Silence by S.A. Barnes. The official pitch for this is Titanic meets The Shining. It's billed as like a horror sci-fi thriller about a soon-to-be unemployed character named Clare who's working with her beacon repair crew when they receive a mysterious distress signal from the depths of space. What's on the other side of that distress signal is extremely shocking because they find the Aurora, a famous luxury space liner that infamously vanished on its maiden voyage across the solar system more than 20 years before. Clare knows that if they board this ship and manage to salvage some artifacts from it, they could be set for life. So she and her crew decide to take that chance, and as soon as they set foot on the Aurora, they know that something is not right on this ship. Again, I think the comparisons make themselves. Much like 1899, this story is about a luxury cruise liner, a missing ship, a mysterious distress signal, and the discovery of what I'm sure are going to be numerous mind-bending, creepy twists along the way, so I cannot wait to read this. An honorable mention for the honorable mention, but if that book sounds interesting to you, then you should watch The Silent Sea, which has a lot of similar elements with an abandoned space station, mysterious deaths, horrific creatures. These are just objective facts. Next, I could not very well make this video without talking about Our Flag Means Death. If you're queer, I'm sure you know all about Our Flag Means Death, and if you don't, then you should. This is a delightfully queer, laugh-out-loud satirical rom-com set during the golden age of piracy, and it's about Steed Bonnet, a self-proclaimed gentleman pirate who's left behind his family, his life, and his wealth to live out his dreams of adventuring across the seas. Not only are he and his crew trying to prove that they are, in fact, cutthroat pirates and try to make a name for themselves, but they also unknowingly cross paths with Blackbeard, who has his own reasons for wanting to stay aboard this ship. If I sat here and talked about all the reasons why you should watch Our Flag Means Death, this video would never end, so I'm going to restrain myself and just say that it's a fucking masterpiece. When I think over-the-top satire, when I think tongue-in-cheek queer romance, when I think about endearing cast of characters where it's idiots all the way down, I think of So This Is Ever After by F.T. Lukens. When this show first came out, a lot of people tried to throw In Deeper Waters by F.T. Lukens into the mix, and I truly cannot emphasize enough that In Deeper Waters, while an incredibly fantastic and unforgettable queer fantasy comedy, is not about queer pirates. I understand where the confusion comes from, but it's not about gay pirates. There are pirates for maybe 10% of the story, and they're not even part of the main plot, and they are not the main characters. With that PSA aside, So This Is Ever After is F.T. Lukens' take on a queer, Arthurian-type fantasy romance that employs all the classic fantasy archetypes in the main cast. This story is about what happens after the hero triumphs and saves the entire kingdom. Arik and his friends just defeated an evil tyrant, fulfilling the prophecy that was set before them, and they've never really thought about what comes next. But obviously this tyrant was the former monarch of this kingdom, and there's no one who can readily take over in his place. So Arik's friends suggest that as a sort of placeholder, Arik should assume the throne himself to give the kingdom some time to sort out its affairs. But little did they know that as soon as someone sits on the throne, they are magically bound to it and submitted to a curse where they have to find their soulmate within a certain amount of time, or magically wither away and eventually vanish. Now Arik finds himself in a race against time with very limited choices, so he figures the easiest thing to do would be to try and woo one of his friends from his adventuring party, and totally not because he's secretly in love with his best friend and most trusted wizard, Matt. Much like Our Flag Means Death, this story is just delightful. It's a breath of fresh air, it's very comedy forward, it's full of hilarious shenanigans and mishaps as Arik tries to trick his friends into confessing that they're secretly attracted to him, and it's just so enjoyable in so many ways. Another similarity I think these stories share is that pretty much everyone involved is queer and weird as fuck, and in so many ways, both stories are also about cast of characters taking on a new adventure in order to prove themselves. On a deeper level, I also love that both of these stories are about characters who are openly healing from trauma and navigating that with their friends, while also realizing that it's never too late to discover your true purpose. Continuing on in the vein of, oh my god, I would die for this show, we have Dead End Paranormal Park. I love animation so much, and this was one of my favorite animated series this year by far, and honestly, just series period, no qualification needed. But I feel like especially if you're looking for something to fill that Steven Universe-shaped void in your life, you should definitely get on this. It's a supernatural series about a trans boy named Barney who's struggling to be accepted by his family. It's not so much that his family rejects him, but they're not showing up to support him as the best allies they can be. So at the beginning of the show, Barney actually takes his dog Pugsley and runs away from home to go work/live in this local celebrity theme park known as Phoenix Parks. Think Dollywood. It's kind of in that same vein because it's a theme park centered around a famous actress named Pauline Phoenix, and it's also very much haunted. So the story is following Barney and his fellow co-worker Norma as they discover the dark secrets lurking beneath the family-friendly veneer of Phoenix Parks. I don't have words enough to express how wonderful this show is. It's smart, it's funny, it's self-aware, it centers around this weird and wonderful little found family, and it has so many great callbacks and pop culture references. And even though it's not the point of the show, it's super cool to have a story that centers a fat trans character who doesn't care whether people judge him for those parts of himself, and who gets to be the hero and to be the glue that holds all these people and pieces together in so many ways. Anyways, that's not the point. The point is, when I was thinking about which book to pair this with, I wanted to find something a little bit spooky and ideally starring a trans character as well, which is how I landed on The Many Half-Lived Lives of Sam Sylvester by Maya McGregor. And for those of you wondering, the answer of Cemetery Boys also still applies. To be clear, there are some implied spooky elements in this story that are never outright named or fully explored, but that I definitely think add to the ominous undertones of the story, but I would definitely say it's more of a murder mystery than anything else. It's a suspenseful story about Sam Sylvester, who's queer, trans, non-binary, and autistic, and they've just moved to Astoria with their dad after some traumatic, transphobic incidents in the Midwest. So they're hoping for a fresh start, but after their own near-death experience, Sam is super interested in researching cases about teenagers passing away, which is how they know that the house they've just moved into was at the center of a murder case in the 1980s. turns out there was a teenage boy who was allegedly killed in that house, and the case eventually went cold. But along with some new friends and a cute new neighbor, Sam has decided to start investigating themselves, and when some threatening notes start to surface and strange things start happening, they know that they're getting close to the real answers. Like I said, Dead End is much more overtly spooky. It has ghosts and demons, it has possession and occult magic and all those good things. But a big part of season one is also a murder mystery, because you find out that Pauline Phoenix, the larger-than-life inspiration behind this theme park, has recently passed away, and her spirit is very much not at rest. So I think that's definitely a big connecting factor between these two stories. They're both dark, strange mysteries that lead the trans main characters down some unexpected paths, even though I would say Sam Sylvester is much more on the contemporary side of things. Again, both stories have great casts of endearing queer characters. Not only that, but they're also really wonderful celebrations of the power of found family and also the power of being unapologetically yourself. The next series might be surprising because it is an older show, but I finally watched it for the very first time this year and I loved it, and that is Over the Garden Wall. If, like me, you've been living under a rock, Over the Garden Wall is a perfectly autumnal, dark, whimsical fantasy series about these two brothers, Wirt and Greg, who are lost in the woods and trying to get back home, but they don't even know how they got there in the first place. And the woods are this grim and dangerous place. They're being hunted by a beast of some kind, and every person they run into seems to be stranger and stranger, and part of their journey will be figuring out who exactly they can trust. This is a truly stunning miniseries, and I loved it because it has a very Alice in Wonderland type vibe. It's an unforgettable journey through this topsy-turvy woodland world that seems to operate on its own bizarre logic, but it's also super sinister and dark. Now, the book series I'm going to mention, I already know, is not a perfect match, especially for those autumnal vibes, but I think it's about as close as I'm going to get right now, and that is The Singing Hill Cycle, which begins with The Empress of Salt and Fortune by Niveau. This is a series of interconnected companion novellas following a non-binary cleric whose job is basically to preserve historical artifacts, events, and stories for future generations. So each novella follows this cleric as they run into different people throughout this empire, and as they're archiving all these different stories, you as the reader are also getting to witness the unfolding of those stories. Again, this might not be the first comparison you think of, but it makes sense to me, especially because of the format. Over the Garden Wall is a very episodic miniseries. Every chapter is almost completely self-contained in a sense. There is an overarching plot that comes to a conclusion by the end, but each episode is a different encounter that these characters are having in this woodland fantasy world, much like how each novella in this series is detailing a unique encounter being experienced by the cleric. I think the storytelling aspect is also a big connecting factor between these two series. It's not just the narrative itself, but the active telling of that narrative that makes both of these stories absolute standouts. There is very much a narrator at the helm of these stories. Both of these narrative lenses give you the feeling that the teller knows much more than you do at any given point. So I think both of these are perfect for people who enjoy creative, whimsical adventures, for those who enjoy gradually discovering pieces of unique fantasy worlds, and for those who want to get lost in the telling of a good story. If any of that describes you, then you can't go wrong with either of these series. I continue to make things difficult for myself because the next show I'm going to mention is Sense8. At its core, Sense8 is another sci-fi drama that's epic in scope, it's multilingual, multinational, and incredibly cerebral in some truly mind-bending ways. Basically, it's about these 8 strangers from around the world who discover that they are psychically and emotionally linked. They can share, exchange, and access each other's feelings, memories, knowledge, language, and skills. So again, I don't think there's a 100% perfect match for this series that I've personally read, but I think one of the closest would have to be The City We Became by N.K. Jemisin. This has a similar premise of being an incredibly ambitious contemporary sci-fi set in the real world as we know it, where 5 complete strangers discover that they are connected by unique powers and share a combined fate. In this story, 5 New Yorkers, all belonging to different boroughs, discover that they are New York's avatars, meaning they've been chosen as its protectors against any evil forces. In this version of the world, all major cities actually have souls, and those souls are split up into different avatars, as is the case with these 5 strangers who realize that a sinister evil is awakening in New York that they have to be prepared to face. I think a huge reason why this duology is a great fit for Sense8 is because this mysterious connection between the characters in both series is incredibly malleable, it's intuitive, it's based on emotion and experience rather than any kind of concrete parameters. Obviously, there's a reason why these strangers are connected in both cases, but the way they're able to exchange power, the way they experience it based on where they come from and what they've been through, is entirely unique, and it changes from person to person. In both cases, all the characters bring something completely different to the group dynamic, and their collective power supersedes any kind of power or influence that they might have as individuals by themselves. I think that's another strong thematic link between these two series, the fact that they're both contending with the concept of the individual versus the collective, and what that struggle looks like in a sort of sci-fi context. If you want a story that has a unique magic, epic sci-fi action, and makes you feel like your brain is just about to melt when the camera finally zooms out on the bigger picture, so to speak, then you should definitely read this, and you should definitely watch this. Switching gears, the next series is, of course, the cultural reset that was the Heartstopper series. Listen, I watched it, you watched it, it ruined all of us, it forever changed my 2022 Spotify Wrapped. I feel like we can all agree on this. I feel like I don't need to describe what Heartstopper is about. At its simplest, it's about two high school boys falling in love, but it's also so much more than that, of course. And if you saw my recent Queer Lit Readathon wrap-up, you know exactly what's coming, but I am gonna say it anyways. If you liked watching Heartstopper, you should read If You Still Recognize Me by Cynthia So. This is a new all-time favorite book. It is a queer contemporary coming-of-age story about a young Chinese-British girl named Elsie who was recovering from a really toxic relationship, which is how she fell into this fandom for a sci-fi comic series. Through that, she met Ada, who writes fanfiction for a sapphic ship in that fandom, and who also happens to live an entire ocean away. But Elsie is seriously crushing on Ada, and she's decided that this is the summer she tells Ada how she really feels. But just before she can do that, her estranged childhood best friend, Joan, re-enters Elsie's life, and the two of them start to reconnect. As I mentioned in my wrap-up, the biggest connecting factor between these two is that they're both so incredibly soft. They're emotionally rich and dynamic, but the way that emotion comes across is very subtle, and it happens in those incredibly quiet, intimate moments. Heartstopper is one of those series that feels very simplistic on the surface. It isn't really action-forward, the conflict is largely internal, but it's incredibly complex and it makes you feel big emotions because you understand exactly what's at stake, and all of those things are also true for this book. The phrase I coined to describe these two in my last video was to say that they both embody a feeling of gentle earnestness. And they both allow the characters to go on a really compelling journey of self-discovery that honors how growth can be fulfilling and exciting while also being an incredibly scary and painful process. Alright, lastly, I do have to admit that I quite enjoyed watching Bridgerton, specifically and only, so far, season 2. I don't much care for season 1, so I'm not going to talk about that, but generally speaking, this series is like a Regency romance set in Europe, and it's following this one fairly wealthy and influential family, the Bridgertons, as the eldest siblings come out in society and try to find a spouse. So the second series follows the second oldest sibling, Lord Anthony Bridgerton, who is a Viscount, and he is a very logical, methodical man who is taking romance out of the equation and just wants to find a suitable wife based on his list of qualifications. When he tries to win over the season's diamond, aka the most eligible girl on the marriage market, he ends up having to go through her older sister, Kate, who does not care for him much. If you know me, you know exactly where this is going. I am gonna make it clear. For this series, the book I would have to recommend would absolutely be A Lady for a Duke by Alexis Hall. This is a historical second chance romance about a trans woman named Viola who was drafted into the war along with her best friend, the Duke of Bracewood, but she was presumed dead in battle and later was able to run away and begin living her life as her true self. Many years later, she hears about the Duke having fallen into depression and ruin since he's been grieving the loss of her, his best friend. And she heard about this because his sister wrote to Viola's sister-in-law expressing concern for her brother's well-being and happiness. So Viola's sister-in-law comes up with this scheme to go visit Gracewood under the guise of helping his younger sister debut in society and begin her season, but really it's a chance for Viola to reconnect with her first love and her best friend. Listen, you want to talk about big feelings? This is the book. Besides the connection of historical romance, that's the biggest connective tissue between these two stories for me. The fact that both of them will make you want to cover your face and scream into the void. The romances in both are incredibly satisfying in so many ways, but I always say Bridgerton wishes it could do the level of drama that A Lady for a Duke does. Don't get me wrong, there's a lot of delicious drama in Bridgerton season 2, but you cannot get more dramatic than logistically coming back from the dead to fall in love with your childhood best friend. You just can't. On a serious note, though, I think something these stories both share is an exploration of what it means to exist outside of society's standards, to live a life that is not deemed to be of propriety in a time where proper society was valued above everything else. When societal influence can dictate the outcome and quality of your life, or even the ability for you to live your life, it has much different implications than just being a popularity contest. And in some ways, both of these romances are about throwing caution to the wind, following your heart, and not only imagining, but creating a future where the happiness that has eluded you for so long can actually exist. Both stories have top-notch banter, plenty of romantic shenanigans and mishaps, some pretty steamy moments, and also tons of heartfelt moments as well. Yes, they're two different stories, but I think if you enjoy one of these, you'll enjoy both of these. I had much more to say about that than I thought I would, but those were some of my favorite TV series from 2022, and the books I think would go along with them. If you've watched any of these yourself and have some different ideas, I would love to hear about them in the comments, or feel free to share a TV show slash book pairing of your own. But that is everything I had to recommend for today. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time, educate yourself, be kind to yourself, take care of yourself, and I will catch you on the flip side of the page.